Trump. We're talking about the current war. Let's get on the current war.
All right, yeah. Gotcha.
Current war. These electricity titans. We all know Thomas Edison, and we know Westinghouse too. George Westinghouse too. Nikola Tesla. Mm-hmm. And these guys were. This movie, The Current War, is really just kind of like a battle of first in a sense, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so what I know the Thomas Edison story. Some of these things that are in the movie. I didn't realize, you know, I didn't realize that he didn't want to use electricity to kill people. You know, that was one of the things. He didn't want electricity to be used for that reason.
There's a, you know, the sort of level the obsession to win gets to, the sort of dirty tricks campaign and the besmirching of an enemy's reputation by demonstrating the debt. So basically, Thomas Edison is DC current, direct current. Westinghouse is AC, alternating current. Alternating current, if you touch any part of the circuit, is fatal. You complete the circuit and you can die, depending how strong it is.
Yeah.
This is all right. Everything is converted back in this room to DC current, so you're safe. Mm-hmm. But still, it'll give you a shock. The point is, in the film, Edison goes to such lengths to demonstrate that, as he did in life. He did a roadshow of death where he basically executed animals that were supposedly strays. He had gangs of people earning money by grouping up strays and also then stealing domesticated animals because they were earning money, and money drives everything, as we know in this sad world. But, you know, this was a really, really despicable, fear-mongering piece of demagoguery stuff that we sadly see today, which kind of makes it relevant in that regard to the current landscape. But it's... It was really, really wakening for me to see that he designed the electric chair in order to discredit Westinghouse, because that was the source of current use for the electric chair. I had no idea about that part of the story.
Wow. I didn't know that part.
I was really disturbed by that. Uh-huh. And, you know, this guy, he may be an out-and-out asshole in how obsessed he gets, but I saw the humanity in him. I did some deep research into him. There's a lot written about him, unlike Westinghouse, who wasn't interested in his personal legacy. He wanted his work to leave the world a better place and for that to be his legacy. Edison was the Steve Jobs of his time. He was the self-promoting. He was the product as much as Steve Jobs was Apple. And in that, he'd worked from very humble beginnings, seventh of seven children, ill a lot during childhood, self-taught at home educated with his mum, but also through reading, and profoundly deaf through scarlet fever, series of ear infections, and an accident that happened on the railways that he worked on as a young lad. He started up a business between selling candy and newspapers and then working on the telegram, the early days of telegrams and telegraphs, you know. And he just was an entrepreneur. He was an inventor at a very early age. He was fascinated, full of wonder with the world, but very, very hardworking, dogmatic, and obsessed. A needle in a haystack kind of a guy. Not a subtle instrument. And I think at this point in the story, he feels threatened. He feels impinged by people trying to steal stuff that he feels he's rightfully marked out as his own. And Westinghouse could have been a great ally. He was a gentleman, industrious, who cared about his employees, who gave them a five-day week. He kind of invented the weekend in Pittsburgh, where he was based. And Edison misread him as another J.P. Morgan, a big money bags who just cared about profit and nothing else. Yeah. And actually, he cared about people, this guy Westinghouse. And so together, they could have been great. But he was a belligerent man, as I said. He had a tough start, Edison, and had worked really hard to get where he got and didn't trust many people. And he misread the situation, and this thing, this ugly, fear-driven thing, just, you know, escalated out of that.
What is that? Yeah.
Yeah. But in amongst it, these people did create the incandescent light bulb, the electric current, the distribution of it. The phonograph, I mean, all of this, you know, microphone, the ability to record a voice.
What we're doing
first
right now.
By Thomas Edison.
This light
the light, everything we take for granted, the screen, so that camera. He invented early technology to do with the motion picture industry, which he patented for a long, long time, to such a stranglehold, again, in his protectionist way, you know, fencing off his own and being really kind of...
Yeah, what was that part about?
Well, I think just like I said, the driving influence of his character, his profound difficulty with hearing, and his sort of blinkered approach to things. You know, he collaborated with the first ever R&D department, research and development. You know, Menlo Park was the original kind of base and experimentation lab where he did collaborate. He worked people to the bone, but they loved him because of the excitement of it. You know, going from like having a light bulb that only lasted 10 minutes, what use is that going to be to the world? When it glowed for 13 and a half hours, he realized then that that was the world changed for good. And just the excitement around that, the magic of it, you know. And I think slightly drunk on his own success, I think all those things fed into his authority. And also, he started to believe the press that he was the Wizard of Menlo Park.
The Wizard of
Menlo Park, the greatest inventor of all time. All these accolades he got in his lifetime. Uh-huh. So. Yeah, that can fame can do bad things to you.
It can hurt you, man. George, and then Westinghouse, did he die broke?
No, that was Tesla.
Tesla more infamously died broke in a hotel room here in New York. You know, this great. The problem with Tesla is he was someone who he was a prophet. He saw 100 years into the future, whereas Westinghouse and Edison are mere 10, which was still pretty amazing.
10 years, pretty good.
That's pretty good. I mean, I'd like that skill, but, you know, this guy was thinking about wireless technology in the late 1800s, Tesla, that is.
Yeah.
He said, why are you obsessed with the generation of electricity and, the, you know, the thing at the other end? What about the wires? Let's get rid of them. Wireless. Amazing.
In the 1800s.
Yeah, man. In the early 1900s, late 1800s. Wow. This guy was a true visionary.
What made you want to do this part?
Everything I've just talked about. I mean, I find that intriguing. Yeah. You know, this guy is difficult. He's a known American icon, so that's quite a heady thing to tackle. Mm-hmm. It first came to me a long time ago, and the history of the film is slightly complicated, but even as a project in itself.
We got shelved, right?
It was, get on to that, but as just as my interest goes, kind of at the beginning, I just thought, okay, this is a tough ask for an English actor to bring Edison to life. Mm-hmm. And the story just amazed me. Like, these were the rock and roll stars of their day. These were, I mean, these were idols and icons of their industry. And they were giving people the Promethean magic, the thing we take for granted, like creating creating day out of night, you know, just flicking a switch, and just the altercation in human history and what that meant. And I found that just amazing. And to bring that to life, not as a history lesson, not as a period drama, but as something that truly held the excitement of that. I thought, that's going to be a challenge.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that kind of whetted my appetite. And he's a complex character, and I don't shy away from that. I like a bit of complexity.
It's good seeing you in this role, because I'm used to seeing you in these big productions with, with
CGI
and all these green screens, these effects and all these things happening.
Dragons and cloaks and all that
exactly.
stuff.
Exactly. Yeah. But I know you shot this a while back, but is that a necessary transition when you play characters?
Listen, I'm so lucky I live in a universe where I get the opportunity to swap cloak for wig or whatever it may be, and I get to move between, you know, the budgets of the sort of megaliths of modern cinema culture and the Marvel franchise, and then also to make and curate and produce as well, you know, films that have a cultural import and on a lower intensity, a lower bandwidth, but are still really important stories, and hopefully with an audience that might be intrigued in my work from Strange, bring that audience to a fresh topic or a different way of making films. Who knows if that works, but I'm really lucky to have that gig where I can do both things. You know?
He's an executive producer with Martin Scorsese, Heather. You know what I mean, Heather?
This is like, I see that.
See what he's doing right here? You know, what was that in temper?
I want these things. I want these things. These applause buttons and these, girl, things. I love it.
Do you back up and let him do his thing, or how often did y'all
Martin
consult?
Has become an amazing support of this film through his relationship with the director, Alfonso Gomez Ojeda, a really talented Mexican genius, really. Me Alone, the Dying Girl, beautiful pay on to cinema itself, but just a beautifully crafted rom-com, which really deep heart, and a teenage adult, whatever you want to call the genre of it. He kind of bust the genre thing with that film. He was so cool, and it was so cool. And he came from working with Thelma Schumacher, Martin Scorsese's editor, and being Martin's assistant for a long, long time. So Martin championed this film. He had a hand in it early on. He helped salvage it from the wreck that an unmentionable person to do with it was there in the background. And we know what that guy was getting up to a little bit more now in private, but in public he was a wrecking ball often with productions, and took this film of Alfonso's and just caused havoc with it. And the great thing I'm here to support and be so proud to be a part of is Alfonso's vision coming to our screen, as it should have been in the first instance. This is why this was this delay, you know, to get the reshoot done, to get it re-edited, to take it out of the hands and the legal battles and everything else that ensued with that story breaking and that man being, you know,
you don't want to say his name.
I don't really. Okay. No, it's like, it's fucking, you know, it's like, you know,
you're my boss.
It's that guy in Harry Potter. It's like that. You don't want to mention his name.
Who shall not be named?
Seriously, he doesn't deserve airtime. So let's just avoid that.
Let's keep
it
moving. All right.
And the point is that, you know, it is his vision that we've got now, and it really holds together. It's a super smart movie. It's funny. It's entertaining. It's riveting, and it's got such a pace and beautiful, beautiful, beautiful looking film as well. And you know, that's Martin and Thelma supporting it, and Alfonso having his vision. And I'm super proud to be a part of that. Yeah. So to answer your question, I don't get in the way of Martin Scorsese on any front. And who would, you know? He's a genius. So.
That's Martin Scorsese. Come on, man. Yeah. Benedict Cumberbatch is here. Before you go.
Yeah.
We prepared a game for you.
Oh.